So first of all, we are thematic investors, which means that we are trying to select those themes which are relevant for many years to come. So we're not that particularly worried about the each individual business cycle. Our investment horizon is 7 to 10 years. And within that, what we try to do is to select themes which will be relevant for many years to come. We also do it in a narrow way, narrow pure play focus, which means our themes are sometimes sharper and narrower in terms of definition and focus than some of the other thematic funds you may see. And that means that you should expect the performance and the growth rate from those portfolios similar to those trends in a pure play way. So in a way, if we're talking about disruptors and innovators in the education sector, which is the focus for this fund, we are planning that this theme will be relevant for many years to come. We can't really tell you the exact growth rate of the theme, but it will be attractive double-digit growth for many years to come. And that's how we select our themes. Yeah, absolutely. What we are doing is we're selecting themes with a very attractive growth prospects, by far higher than the growth in global GDP. Typically, our themes are growing in double digits. Even within the education sector itself, where we're looking, which is the focus for this fund, we are growing faster than education sector itself, several times faster than even the education sector, which is by itself growing faster than GDP, because we are focusing specifically on disruptors and innovators in that area. So this is, our funds are completely bottom up, which means we are not looking at macro or sectors or countries as such. We try to select companies which disrupt and innovate. And that means that those companies come from wherever in the world we find them. It's a difficult task, in a way, going industry by industry, market by market, and finding those innovative companies. And that means that our fund profile gives you a good exposure to all countries and all industries without any specific macro allocation. So specifically with this fund, which is what makes it a little bit unusual, we have less companies in the US. So it's about a third of the fund will be in North America. We have a lot of companies in emerging markets, more than a third from emerging markets, and we have a lot of Asian companies and practically no European companies, because these companies are selected such that where there is the greatest need for innovation. If you look at the education sector is a big burden on spent in emerging markets, because it's all finance out of the pocket, which is why there is a lot of innovation happening there. A lot of innovators found in emerging markets, which is reflected in the fund, which has a lot of exposure, as I say, to emerging markets, a lot of exposure to Asia, and overall it's companies coming from all sectors. So if you look specifically at the profile, the biggest part, let's say roughly 40%, will be from consumer discretionary, as education sector is with it. Then next biggest part, probably IT, maybe a quarter of the fund. And the rest will be split roughly between communication services and industrial services. There are some companies coming from other sectors, like healthcare, for example. But it's a really global portfolio, as I say, different countries, different sectors, which also makes it a good complement to your existing positions or to other thematic funds in our range, because it gives you different sectors and different countries. Okay, so you are right, there is a lot of concentration in client portfolios in terms of US and US tech sector specifically. And even if you look through the portfolios, many of the clients would be exposed to positions like Apple and Microsoft and Google, which are found practically in every global portfolio and every US tech portfolios. So that means that there is an increase in concentration. What we're doing with our funds is different, because, as I say, we approach this on a pure play rationale, which means that we invest in companies which are specialist. Typically these companies are much smaller, which means that if you add this fund to our thematic funds, other thematic funds in our range, to your existing portfolio, you are unlikely to see overlap. So we will not have companies like Microsoft, Apple, and Google in those portfolios. And as I said, in this specifically in this education fund, edutainment fund, we have limit, well, not explicit limit, but our tech exposure is roughly a quarter. The rest is coming from other sectors. And likewise, it's very small proportion relative to the index if you compare it to any index like MSCI ESG leaders, like for our index or MSCI World, it will be underweight US relative to that index. It's a very interesting question, because education, and we've been marketing this fund around the world, it clicks with many people on different levels. So some start by looking at the innovation and disruption in this very large sector globally, and the sector is 5 trillion global spend, out of which only 2 or 3% digital. So from the opportunity point of set, it's very interesting. So some people are attracted to this growth opportunity in a large sector being disrupted, and we're just at the beginning of this journey. Other people are attracted to a very strong link to the UN Sustainable Development Goals, because education links to reduction of poverty. It's very important for emerging markets. As I say, in our portfolio you could find a lot of emerging market stocks, and there is a direct link to UN Sustainable Development Goals, because in a way we're encouraging companies to innovate to bring the costs of education down, and those high costs is what made education exclusive to rich people, exclusive to rich countries. So we're very much aligned with the UN SDG goal. We also have a very strong ESG process behind this fund. And finally, these days a lot of people are interested in mega trends or super trends, and for us this is a direct link to millennials, because these are your students. It's millennials, or so generations X and Y and Z, which is after millennials. These are the digital natives, so these are the kids which grown up with technology, iPads perhaps as their first toy. They spend a lot of time online. They're very familiar with Spotify, Netflix, and all other business models, and practically the only place where they still face the traditional delivery of education content is in school. So that means that when those technologies are available, those kids are the early adopters. So that means it's a very attractive opportunity set. First of all, you come into interesting disruption of a very large sector, your early stage there. Second, you have an alignment with ESG and UN Sustainable Development Goals. And third, it's a very strong link to megatrends, specifically millennials. And that's what makes this opportunity very unique. And we're very happy to be the first fund of its kind in the world to target this opportunity.